Hey, what is going on, guys? Ali here, back again with another Fire Force review for Season 2, Episode 9, and I gotta say, very fun. It was a lot more action. First of all, Ogun with those fire tats he had going on, pretty freaking awesome. That fight was amazing. Animation was fantastic and everything. Obviously, sound effects being at Fire Force was just obviously like awesome and everything. And just seeing the whole fight in general. And then Tamaki going in hot, trying to protect Shinra because he's connecting with the woman in black and everything. And Scop was there, and he yelled her name to like get her to at least try and help, and they know that she is in the tabernacle and everything. So we got Juggernaut, which when Juggernaut got a hole in his body, like protecting Tamaki, like I almost lost it. I was like, this dude's gonna die in this arc, like because I love Juggernaut and everything, and like for him to die in his homeland is kind of like it would feel very symbolic or whatever, but like the whole thing was just funny. Like I at first I was horrified. I thought Juggernaut was gonna die because he's such a fun character, and I love the dude like so much and everything. So when he got a hole in his body and then Tamaki is like freaking out and like almost crying or whatever, but then all of a sudden like you see a hand come out from like the hole, and that like he's probably like an extremely scrawny or extremely skinny person because he also got shredded up by the dogs and stuff. And that didn't happen. Nothing happened to him. Like he got like his coat back. So I'm like, what? Like, how is his body like formed or something? Which it was weird and it was funny, but at the same time, like I went through so many emotions just looking at that when he first got that hole. I was horrified and I was like about to cry. Like, no, please. But then like they made it comedic like right after, being that like his body is probably like so skinny that like he has like about a dozen different coats inside, like it will like covering him or something. That's why he looks big. So and then like that whole part was funny to me. It was like a good gag, but also like something horrifying. That was like, I didn't want that to happen, but like, bro, that was crazy. So now let's go to Ogun and his fire tats, bro. Like the like seeing Tamaki talk about like the rumor of Ogun being that like that one recruit that was like a huge rumor going around all the companies, and that like there was a recruit for Company 4 that could temporarily be able to use firepower on the level of Captain Burns. And I'm like, what? Like, I freaked out and I was like, this dude looks like he's straight up manhandling freaking the demon. And I'm in my head, I'm like, he could probably put this demon out. But then if he probably does that because it's a temporary ability that Ogun does, that like if he actually tries to do that firepower towards the demon, like full power, that he also would be disintegrated probably. Like that's probably even less likely for him to survive than when Conroe did that ability when he destroyed that demon, that firepower, whatever. I think that like in terms of like firepower in fighting and whatnot, Conroe I think has a higher level of firepower to like be able to deal with and survive, and then Ogun being able to temporarily use the same level of Captain Burns' like firepower, like it's crazy, but also at the same time it wouldn't be something that Ogun would actually do to take out a demon, because he probably knows for a fact that if he used it to take out the demon, he would probably immediately die and like disintegrate or incinerate or something. Like that's crazy, and like his ability was just awesome. Loved it. Loved his spears and whatnot that he used. The whole fight was like amazing and amazing there. So now let's go into what's happening in the tabernacle. You got Pan leaked and Arthur, and Arthur doesn't even actually know. Like he's subconsciously a super genius. Like they're talking about, how did you know that was pie or whatever? And then like he's talking about him like knowing what these are by saying like these weird ass names or whatever, and that like he studied all round like things, like everything circle. He tried to study all of that, so it's talking about the round table, and then like it's like the circumference of the 3.14 is like the circumference of a circle's like the diameter or something like that, like the that Licht was talking about. And then all of a sudden Arthur's like, by the way, like, what is pi and what is the round table? Like, Arthur really doesn't know. Like, I'm so confused. Like, Arthur is one of the best boys, 100%. One of the best boys, and that was just hilarious to see that. And then, so they went closer to, like, the central core of the tabernacle, and they're hearing some sort of heartbeat, right? And then they see a white feathered arrow in a key slot, and then there's seven arrows, like, on the side with keys as, like, the dart or whatever, or the point to the arrow. And then Licht was talking about how these are probably sacrifices and whatnot, and saying that, like, Joker's investigations were true about what's going on. And, like, it sees, we see seven arrows, right? One in the core of the tabernacle, right? So I'm seeing those, talking about the eight pillars, that they're actually all sacrifices, and that the first pillar was probably a sacrifice for Amaterasu, and she's stuck in there. Just like how the woman in black is stuck in the core of the tabernacle. But at the same time, I don't see the woman in black as an Edola burst or anything. Because she also gives grace to Shinra, is going to give grace to Shinra, but then Shinra, like, or maybe like an Edola burst, like, eventually is able to give their own grace or something, and maybe she might be an actual Edola burst, or like a pillar of, like, beyond the spatial rift she was or something, and then she came over here to this world to recreate it, meaning revitalize it or something. And there's just a lot more questions now about what's going on, in that, like, you see her talking to Shinra in the Edola Link, saying that, like, I only have enough power to preserve the forest and everything, to keep the forest from dying out and everything. And I'm like, man, like, I think that all these arrows linking to all of these, like, the tabernacle and the Amaterasu and stuff, it's to help preserve things. Like, that's what those keys are for. And that's really what the the Edola bursts are for, is to preserve and revitalize and recreate the world and everything. So it's like, Shinra gonna have to eventually go to, like, a facility that resembles, like, the Amaterasu, the tabernacle, and he's gonna become a core or something, just like everybody else. But at the same time, I feel like the woman in black is like the opposite of the evangelist, but they can still give grace, like, in somewhat of the same way. I think the evangelist is evil, which is crazy, because, like, usually light and dark is, like, dark is evil, and then light is, like, sometimes good, like, angelic or whatever, but it's, like, now, it's, like, the evangelist is bad, and then the woman in black is a good person. Like, I knew from the moment I saw the woman in black that she was a good person, because she's trying to preserve the forest. She's asking them to protect the forest. You got Scop in this episode being like, please, like, help, like, Shinra and whatnot. And she's saying, like, yeah, I heard you guys, but the only amount of grace that I could actually give you guys, or give you, Shinra, is only a second. And Shinra's like, that's the only amount that I need and everything. So we got that going on next episode, that's gonna happen there. And then, like, you see the woman in black just being like, you see, like, last episode you saw her creepy looking, and now this episode you see her crumbling, kind of like crumbling away and looking very sad, you know? So it's sad that's happening to her, but, like, she is the core to preserving that forest and everything, and keeping the tabernacle running, and that's why life is still, like, thriving and everything. But the evangelist is trying to make these things explode and blow up and destroy the world. I think that the cataclysm thing happened, that to where, like, that caused her to come out of the spatial rift, to actually recreate or revive or revitalize the world after that catastrophe that happened. She had nothing to do with the cataclysm. In my eyes, she had nothing to do with the Great Cataclysm. I think the Evangelist had something to do with the Great Cataclysm, and then, like, that whole thing happened, but then, like, life started coming about again with, like, the Tokyo Empire and what happened with the Amaterasu and everything, and then, like, the Tabernacle with that giant forest going on and such. Like, I think, I'm starting to think, I don't know why, but I think the first pillar was bad, but then she became locked inside the core of Amaterasu by, say, the ancestors of Vulcan or something, along with Rallus, the first or whatever, with his disciples and such, that they actually put her into that and everything. Maybe the first pillar actually isn't evil, I have to see her as evil, because she instigated Inca and instigated Shinra into, like, just destroying everything. So I think that she is actually evil, and then the woman in black is good. But I think she, the woman in black, is just the opposite of the Evangelist. She's not just an Adola burst or whatever, because she is going to give Shinra grace. Unless the Adola bursts and whatnot eventually are able throughout time, they're able to at least give grace or something like that. Which, like, it's a lot of questions going on. And I really like this episode in that, like, all those questions with those arrows. What's going on? Why doesn't Arthur even know what pi is? Or even, like, or what the round table is? Like, what's going on there, right? And then you got the woman in black talking about, like, the only power I have left is to, at the very least, preserve the forest. I can't give somebody grace. I can't give you, like, a lot of, like, grace, whatever. The amount of time that I can give you is just a second of grace. What can you do with that? And then Shinra's like, that's plenty. I can do that. And then you got Ogun with his fire tats and everything. Him, Tamaki, Juggernaut going in on this demon so they can give Shinra some time and everything. And, like, it was just so good that, oh my god. And the animation, obviously, like, always on point with Fire Force. And it was a really, really, really good episode in terms of, well, actually, it was just a great episode overall, because it was an amazing fight and everything. A lot of information with, like, sacrifices and stuff, and then Joker's investigations being right about what's going on with the Amaterasu and the Tabernacle and all the pillars and all the Adola bursts and stuff, and all of these arrows, like, these white arrows and everything, like, being sacrifices, and, oh, man. And honestly, I really like the woman in black. Honestly, she seems like a really, really cool character and just person overall. She seems like such a great person. She used herself in general to bring back life. And that's just, I feel like that's such a beautiful thing and everything. So, like, her character is great. Then her connecting with Shinra. And then Shinra's about to use an Adola grace. And it's called Adola grace now. So, like, it makes me think that Adola Burst can eventually give Adola grace and everything. So, yeah, like, it was a good episode. A lot of it was from what happened with Shinra and Ogun and Tamaki and Juggernaut on the outside and everything, all the way to the core with what was happening with Pan, Licht, and Arthur and everything. Great stuff. And then Arthur, again, not knowing even what pi is, but for some reason he has that in his head about what pi is. Like, I'm like, huh? What? So that was really great. But anyways, that is the end of the episode with Shinra being like, 1 second is enough for me to use grace to take out this demon, to put this demon to rest and everything. And I thought that Ogun did a crazy good job with, like, just fighting off the demon in general. It was crazy awesome. So, like, again, if he used all of his firepower to, I think he would be able to put that monster, put that demon to rest, but he would have died in the process, and that's why he's not doing it to me, because it looks like he was manhandling that demon like it was nothing or something. So that was crazy, and that was good and everything. All of it was good and stuff. So I'm excited to see Shinra using grace again, which is going to be really epic and really awesome and everything. So I'm excited to see it. But again, what did you guys think about this episode? Your thoughts about the woman in black being a good person, like a good character and everything. Leave down in the comments your overall thoughts of the episode, your thoughts about what I said in Snutch. And like this video if you did. Like the video if you liked the episode. Like the video if you liked anything I had to say. And subscribe to the channel for more reviews, vlogs, unboxings, live reactions, and theater discussion videos and things like that. So gentlemen, stay classy, ladies, stay sexy, but most important, everybody, you gotta stay a little nasty, alright? So peace and love, and I will see y'all later in the next video. Peace out, may the force be with you always, plus ultra and latom.